Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Better planet for our descendants to live on and for us until we're gone. Be with us in every phase of life. Help us to do the right thing. Be with our military worldwide to keep us free, to keep us at bay from those who would do us harm. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Tim. Good morning, everyone. We'll call the meeting to order officially. This first meeting in March 2013, Alamance County Board of Commissioners. We're glad that you're here. First item on the agenda after calling the meeting to order is to hear public comments. I believe we have three individuals that would like to speak this morning. First one, we'll call on Mr. Tony Cox to talk about an ordinance. Mr. Cox, welcome.
Not an ordinance reform. If you don't live in Alamance County, in the county, outside of any municipality or the ETJ jurisdiction of the municipalities, you don't know what it's like. With anything in the United States of America, until you become a victim, you do not know what it's like to be a victim. If you go to our ordinances and try to make any sense out of the ordinances, my opinion, and I'm no attorney, I'm no professional in the legal, I just use common sense and my thought process as an American citizen. We the people, we can only vote out elected officials whenever it comes due to be voted out or in, those that do a good job for us. But administrators, we have no control over. I don't believe, let me restate that. Tricky questions. Tricky answers. Back in 2007, Mickey Crutchfield said before the commission, he said, Tony Cox is a good boy. I've known him for years. The Alamance County commissioners at that time said, no, Tony Cox ain't a good old boy. But we see through these commissioner meetings, people come in here all the time that are good old boys. But the ones that ain't good old boys, some of those become victims. Senate Bill 125 says that, and I hope they pass it, the difference is for transparency, instead of it being a misdemeanor and a $200 fine, it be a felony. And the people not have to pay for it, but the people that violate those laws pay for it. I invite every one of you commissioners to look at all of our Alamance County ordinances that are listed on the website. Some of them have been put on moratoriums. Some of them have been rescinded. I don't know if they were used. It's time for reform of these ordinances. The people should not be subjected to these types of laws and rules. Thank you. Could I ask a question?
Thank you, Tony. Not at this time, but I would encourage you to talk to staff about specific concerns that you may have.
Thank you.
Our next public comment speaker is Alexa Jordan. Ms. Jordan?
Good morning. I'm Alexa Jordan.
I expected her to be here to speak on behalf of the Human Relations Council. And so your next speaker is Ann Kassebaum, and I'd like to speak with you as a member of the council. She is our chair. I'm not speaking officially for the council, but I know from our last meeting that the council wanted to be represented. Let me start with a question. I understand from watching the video of your last meeting that you were going to speak with her about denying Scott Ziente a place on the council. Has that conversation occurred?
And all we do is send that back to the council. We have not, I haven't talked to anyone, and we normally would not. It would go back to your, to the Alamance County Human Relations Council.
We have not received that communication yet. And I wanted to tell you why the council is eager to have Scott Ziente on. Our mission is to see that all people living in Alamance County are treated with fairness and decency. And this is in the workplace, this is just across the board, in housing arrangements, in all areas. So we try to be a diverse board representing many points of view. We've eagerly sought someone from El Centro to come to the board for a number of years. Like many boards, we have trouble getting committed members to serve. And we have wanted someone from El Centro. So we were very pleased when Scott Ziente agreed to be on the board. He's a very thoughtful person, and I think he can add a lot. He has already shown a willingness to work, to do things outside of meetings, and to attend meetings regularly, because people attend while they wait to get on the board. So we're eager to cooperate with you. We know you also, you said it in the last meeting, well, this is a very important board. So we ask you to reconsider this and probably to have a meeting with us so that we can cover this more fully with you.
May I ask you a question?
Yes.
Do you not think that people on this, your board, and I support what you're doing there, we all need to get along better. But we need to get along better under the auspices of the U.S. government, the state laws, and the local laws.
Mm-hmm.
Do you feel like that a person on this board should be void of any political agenda?
I don't know anyone who's void of any political agenda, so...
On a board like this, I mean, there are people on boards all across the United States, bank boards, business boards, and they don't have a political agenda. They have an agenda to do the right thing.
That's right.
That's right. Do you not believe that everybody on these boards, your board should, that everybody should be free of having a political agenda?
I believe that Scott Ziente, I don't believe anyone's free of having a political agenda, but I believe he acts fairly, yes.
You don't think he has a political agenda?
What do you mean by political agenda?
Because I don't know how else to
some people would say you're well known for your political
yes,
agenda.
Yes, ma'am, I'm proud of him.
Yeah, okay.
And I don't
people have a right to vote for us. They don't have a right to vote for who you appoint. He is a member of Fairness Alamance, and he is a radical leftist. And I'm not going to vote for him to come on this board. We don't need people like that is stirring the pot. We need people who can get along in this country, and with outside influences like that, we don't need that. We need people who are working for the good of Alamance County, not to pull us down.
Well, it's interesting. I see him as someone who is definitely working for the good of Alamance County. He's committing to serving the Latino community. He's not doing this for a high...
Are you familiar with Fairness Alamance?
Yes, I am. I attend meetings.
Okay, that tells me what I need to know. Okay.
But you're banning people from this committee who have shown a commitment to improving relations in this county.
I don't think that's not... improving relations when you got outside influence trying to make illegal immigration acceptable. That's not acceptable. They need to pass the same laws and rules that you and I live by. We shouldn't give them amnesty for for breaking our laws.
Well, Fairness Alamance is committed to fair treatment of immigrants in our county. And from my understanding, something like 287G's Secure Communities was interested in deporting felons.
Change the law. This is a country of laws.
Well,
you don't pick and choose the laws that you want to enforce. We enforce all of them. If you don't like it, you change the law. And until the law is changed, it should be enforced.
Well, I have to ask you why the United States Department of Justice is coming in to investigate
Ann, I'm
activity.
Going to have to interject here. This is not the forum for that debate. It is not.
But we're talking about law.
Well, no, we're talking about a debate right
okay.
now. And I appreciate you coming and expressing your sentiments, but we need to move on.
Okay. I will leave you with one question. Would this group of commissioners allow Rosa Parks to have been a member of the Human Relations Council?
As I said, we're not going to debate that point anymore, but thank you for coming. Are there other commissioner responses at this time to any public comments? If not, let's review the agenda. Craig, good to see you back in the saddle. Do you have any changes for the agenda that we have in front of us?
No, sir.
Commissioners, thank you, Craig. Commissioners, if you'll take just a minute and review the consent agenda, are there any items this morning on the consent agenda that anyone would like to have removed for further discussion?
I'd like to know more about C.
The signatory resolution.
I looked at that, all the paperwork we got. I have no idea what that's all about.
Your name's on it.
Yeah, I was getting ready to say.
Okay, we're going to remove C.
He wants unlimited authority.
Amy or Susan, are you all in a position to talk about that when we get to the point?
Yes.
Okay. Let's remove item, it would be currently 5C, and we will discuss that. How about after the budget amendments? We'll call it 6A, if that'll work.
Okay.
Thank you, Bill. Any other items that we need to pull from the consent agenda? If not, we'll entertain a motion to approve the agenda as amended by that one removal, which would include then the remaining items on the consent. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Thank you, Linda. Bill, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, then that takes us down, thank you, to the budget amendments. We have three to consider. First, from the Finance Department, budget amendment number 65. We're going to hear from Susan Roberts. Good morning.
Good morning, Commissioners. I'm requesting for us to transfer $1,245 from the general fund to the emergency telephone fund to cover expenses as directed by the E911 board.
You need a motion?
Yeah.
So moved.
Is there a second on amendment 65? Thank you, David. Any discussion or questions for Susan? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Budget amendment 66 from the Department of Social Services. Welcome, Susan Osborne. Susan, good morning.
Good morning. This is a budget amendment to add to our Comprehensive Family Assessment Grant of year 5, no cost extension. So as you remember, I was before you just a month ago with year five updating that, and this is a no cost extension. So this fund carries us through September 30th, which is just the no cost extension year that we finally received allocation authorization on. We'll finish up that grant the end of September.
Questions for Susan? Is there a motion to approve this amendment?
Moved.
Second.
Linda. Thank you, Dave. David offers a second. Any other discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Thank you.
Thank you, Susan. And budget amendment 67, Recreation and Parks. Brian, good morning.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good.
Here to request this morning that you allow the department to accept a total of $5,000 from the Burlington Alamance County Convention and Visitors Bureau. We plan to use $3,000 of these funds to replace interpretive signs out at Cedar Rock Park Historic Farm, and the remaining $2,000 to do some paid advertising promoting the Hall River Trail in Alamance County, in hopes that people will from outside the county will come and make use of the trail.
I think that's a good way to inform the people what we've got out here. I'll support that. I'll make the motion.
Second.
Thank you, Bill. David, other questions for Brian? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Signatory resolution presented by the Finance Department. Who gets the...
That, Mr. Lashley, is just actually updating our resolution. Our cards, signature cards at the bank and all are correct.
Okay.
This had not been updated in a couple of years, so it had the wrong names on it. So that's just updating it.
Okay.
And it's also changing our limit where we did have any checks over $10,000 had to be manually signed. And this is increasing that limit to $100,000.
Okay, thank you.
Amy, I did see that you talked about signature facsimile. I don't think I've ever given you one, have I? A signature for you to do?
Yes,
that?
You
I have.
Mm-hmm.
Does Bill need to do that?
It's a digital signature. We've got both of them.
Okay. Okay. Oh, that's we signed in those little blocks.
Right. Yeah. That's correct.
Okay. Bill, you pulled this off consent, so we will have to have a separate motion for approval.
Okay, I'll move it.
Position to make that motion?
I'll make that motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
Before we vote, can I ask a related question to that process of after the vote, maybe? Or
now?
You know, I asked a couple months ago, you know, we used to put out to bid where we had our payroll. In other words, we would switch banks or stay. What's the process and rules on that? Because I haven't got any feedback on that.
We can bank bid at any time. We can bank bid a little bit.
What's the rules, though?
I don't know if there's any specific rules. It's just that we have to send out a request for proposal that we would send out to bank, local banks, and get their feedback.
I know that in the past, like when Larry was our chairman, you know, he was with the bank, and so forth, we had a sort of a consensus opinion that we should, you know, keep it at the same place, or that we ought to definitely, you know, rotate it or put it out to bid or whatever to show that we weren't favoring a particular bank or somebody could perceive it as being that. And I just wondered, you know, what the process was. Because I know we hadn't, how long has it been where it's at without mentioning the name of the bank? You can mention the name.
It's probably been there, I'm guessing, 9 or 10 years.
Yeah,
We did look into that, Mr. Sutton, a couple of years ago, and because of the interest rates and all, a couple of banks that I talked to said that it would probably end up costing us more to do it at that time because of the interest rates and all, so we kind of put that on the back burner. But it is something that we can look at. You know, I was just kind of waiting for
Is there not a policy, though, is what I'm saying?
Not
that I'm aware of. It's just, there's probably template bank proposals that you would send out, a request for proposal, you know, looking at different accounts. You know, we do have different accounts at different banks.
Yeah, we've got, we've got investments and different things spread, you know, within different banks. But our main account has been where it's at probably for about 10 years.
I can't prove it, and I'll be quiet after this. I can't prove it, but I thought we sort of had a consensus opinion that after 2 years we ought to consider moving.
I agree with Tim. That's what came up with when that thing was.
Was that not right, David?
Yes.
Is that not the case?
Yeah. 9 years is a long time to be at one place. I'm not trying to get it away from, I don't even know where it's at, so I just showed you I don't have anything against that bank. Couple of banks I got a few things against, but whatever. I mean, I think we need to look at it.
Okay.
That's my personal opinion.
Thank you, Tim. Before we vote, I just must comment that none of these accounts are currently with the bank that I'm avoiding. I did not compensate Tim Sutton for making any comments about changing the bank. But thank you for putting that plug in there. I'll give you our address, Craig, a little bit later. Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve the signatory resolution. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, very good. Item number 7, special non-residential intensity allocation requests. Morning, Jason. Jason Martin, our planning manager.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, good morning. You should have in your packet a memorandum from me as well as some backup information regarding this special non-residential intensity allocation request. In short, the Chief Michael Burnett of the AO Fire Department approached the Planning Department regarding the watershed requirements to build a new substation off of Stony Creek Church Road. Being that that is in the balance of watershed area, there are built-upon limits placed in that area of 12%, which is anything that's considered impervious to water, which would be buildings, parking areas, gravel, pavement, and so forth. In order to do the substation as requested, the chief has requested a special non-residential intensity allocation allotment. Basically, 10% of every watershed area is set aside to allow for greater density development, which would allow this to go up to 70% built upon area. And in that particular watershed, I think there's roughly 2,900 acres that are allowed to do that with. And so the Planning Department would maintain a inventory of this. To my knowledge, this is the first time that this has been requested. At least in the 9+ years I've been with the county, it's never been requested. As from a procedural standpoint, this request went to the Planning Board for a recommendation. The Planning Board at their February meeting did recommend approval to the Board of Commissioners. And just for your reference, there is a copy of the letter there as well as the plat of the property. And I also put an aerial in there too, so it kind of puts some visual to it. That being said, I will be glad to take any questions from the board at this time, and I know Chief Burnett is here as well to answer any questions if you have specific questions about the substation that's being built.
So moved.
What would you do if there was a school that wanted to go out in one of these areas?
The same procedure would be followed. This is allowable for institutional uses. A school would be an institutional use as well.
Yeah. So does the state have to approve it?
No, state does not. It's just something that comes through. The Board of Commissioners has final approval on it.
I'll second Dave. I didn't mean to interrupt his motion, but just want to ask you a question.
We have a motion and a second. We have any other questions for either Chief Burnett or Jason? Welcome to you, sir. Appreciate what y'all are doing. If not, we'll call for the question. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Thank you, Jason. Sir.
Item number 8, County Manager's Report. Greg?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and again, good to be back. I appreciate the board's understanding and prayers during my son's recent illness, so I do thank you. Ben Pierce is going to give you an update on peak resources. One of the things the board asked for at our last meeting was kind of a timeline of peak and where we're at and how we got to this point. So I appreciate Ben working on this and coming up with this timeline. So.
Okay, I've got a handout here that I believe was originally probably prepared by Mr. Smith discussing what had happened. It looks like January of 1976. January of 1976, the county or Care Inns purchased the 4 acres on Woody Drive, and the county created the Healthcare Development Corporation, which was a nonprofit to allow tax-exempt status for the healthcare development bonds, which was a program. Those bonds were issued. The rent on the facility was set at the repayment, the principal plus interest for those bonds with a 25-year lifespan. In 1982, Care Inns used some leftover funds from that bond issue to purchase the 3-acre lot beside it. So this timeline deals with the 4-acre track that the facility is on, but the vacant lot next door is also included within this. Then it goes down, there were some various mergers of different Care Inns, became several different companies. In 1991, the county leased a portion of the land, or Care Inns leased a portion of land out there to AAA Signs, which is now Fairway Advertising, the county's. Last year, we renegotiated that contract. I think they pay us $9,000 a year now for the use of that sign. But going down through the, in 2001, the property reverted back to Alamance County. The bonds were fully paid off. And pursuant to the charter, that came back to the county. Commissioner Smith was involved in doing a 10-year lease to Vencor, which later became Kindred. In October 2010, Kindred told us that they were not going to renew their option on that property. December, we put it out to bid via RFP. We chose Peak in January. In May, at the end of the term with Vencor, Peak took over. In May of 2012, Commissioner Boswell suggested that staff should look at any surplus property that the county owned. Subsequent conversations what led to the Graham Manor, and we went through all the tax records and registered deeds records looking for all the property that the county owned and what could be surplus, what could be disposed of, and there wasn't a whole lot. But as a part of that, we contacted Peak and said, hey, we're interested in selling it. If you're interested in buying it, give us an offer. And they had an appraisal done. That appraisal was what came back at $2.5 million. They submitted that to us in November, late November, and then that's what we had brought before y'all last month, just to say we have a substantiated offer to purchase this property, but obviously what they're willing to buy it for and what we're willing to sell it for don't have to be the same.
Who did the appraisal on that property?
I don't remember.
I mean, can we get that?
We have a copy of it.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
They sent us a copy of that along with their office. That's one of the things that we had asked for, because we said we don't have any idea this property would be worth.
That facility is located on the 3 acres.
That facility is located on a 4-acre tract.
4-acre tract.
And then beside that is a 3-acre tract, which basically completes the square. I don't know why they only purchased 4 acres of it, but the total that the county owns now would be the 7 acres.
7 acres.
But did they offer, was there offer for the full 7 or just
for the full 7? Yes.
For all of it.
Because they want that for extra parking and
to expand.
Yeah, to do some things out there. So that's what we have leased to them. What we leased to Vencor also was that 7 acres.
Can we get a copy of the appraisal?
I've submitted it to the county manager's office, so we can certainly get you one.
Yeah, my question, and I talked to Clyde a little bit about this, I'm still not totally clear on the right to the beds, which to me is the real long-term asset here. Mm-hmm. You know, the arguments and discussions about the building needing repairs, I think that's certainly valid. And if it were just the building itself, I think we'd probably be more interested in, you know, looking at options, but until I get a comfort level knowing how the certificate of need process works with the respect to reissuance of existing beds that somebody controls, either the lessee or the county, what's the state's involvement on that? I just am not clear on that.
And I'm not either. The intricacies of that certificate of need process are great. We haven't had a lot of substantive conversations in how we would do that, but we've transferred them twice now, and Peak, who has been through this, they own several facilities. They're building a new one in Charlotte. They've got at least half a dozen different facilities, hasn't expressed any kind of concern over our ability to do that. So I'm not sure, and that's one of the things that we would kind of push to them and their legal staff, because they're much more qualified to handle that. But I can investigate further with the state about how the exact mechanism by which that certificate of need would be transferred, but right now that's just not something I can speak
to. Susan may know. Do you know, Susan?
I don't know the intricacies.
Yeah, I can tell you that Alamance County has a surplus of beds at this point. So, and I know that when those beds are issued, they are generally they don't call them back. But at this point, it's very unlikely they're going to be issuing any new skilled nursing beds for Alamance County. So the beds that we have are a more valuable resource because they're not likely to be any others.
Well, my suggestion is just me. I would like for you to talk directly to the people at the state, because if we leave it up to Peak, obviously they're going to research what's in their best interest on keeping the beds. But do we have the right, for instance, if they decided to move, do the beds go with them? Do the beds revert back to us? How do we put a value on the beds? Who else might be interested in the beds? I mean, to me, that's what we need to be looking
at. Yeah, and we have had interest. We have another group that is interested in those beds. That has contacted us. So I can certainly have that conversation with the state and try to get into all this certificate.
I just think when you look at all our options, I mean, the beds are what's important.
Yeah. Well, that 7 acres of land is
that's a hard ass. Not far from the interstate.
That's right. Yeah. Mighty valuable.
Is the inquiry about the beds for another facility or another location?
I believe that's their plan, yes, is to take the facility that's there. I don't believe they have an interest in keeping that facility. So whether or not we sell the bed separate from the facility could be an option, or how we want to structure it. We can structure it however, if it's some kind of long-term payment, or whether we take all our cash up front or whatever, but there is an interest in doing all these
beds. But hypothetically, if Peak folded or went belly up, you know, went bankrupt or moved out, you know, what would happen? You know, if you could find out an answer as to what our responsibility would be for the patients and or the beds or the facility, if Peak just packed up and left.
Yeah. I don't think at this point we have any real responsibility. There's a statute that allows a county to operate a nursing home. These were not issued under that statute. So this is not a county-operated nursing home. This is just a nursing home owned by the county. So I don't think that that any kind of liability from that would fall back on us. We are the landlord only.
Well, who would take over the state situation? How would it work?
I think we would have to find someone.
Okay, so that's what I'm trying to get at. You know, you need to know every possible solution before. I mean,
I think they would move the patients out.
The state would.
Yeah. The company would probably move them out before they left, but if they didn't, somebody would come in and move them out within a week.
Yes.
But the county, you don't think, would be liable to do it?
When a family care home or things like that close, we have some responsibility to find placement for those who are disenfranchised or about to be homeless.
So it's possible we would be liable.
Well, but
have responsibility in assisting.
Yeah, I think that would fall under our social services duties rather than our owner of the certificate of need duties.
But it's that ownership of the certificate of need that, to me, is unclear. Okay. What value is that? Obviously, it's transferable because we've done that, right? Mm-hmm.
We've done it twice now.
It would be hard to put a value on that, on those beds.
Yeah, and that is one of the issues. I've contacted, there's a company out of Durham that does consulting on these certificate of need type issues. And I had initial conversations with them, but without a retainer, they were unwilling to really get into the intricacies of how we would value this.
Well, you can always use the income approach, because you certainly can determine the income, and you can get a value on that by using the income approach to it. Very easy.
Sure. And that is what, within that appraisal that Pete gave us, is supposed that they have factored that in, and that's how they came to their $2.5 million figure. So,
well, I would imagine that the folks at the state that issue that, they would have resources for us to consider as well. So,
okay.
But I think that's an important piece.
Yeah, I think that land's worth $2.5 million. And the building, I don't know what it's worth, but the beds are worth something in addition to that $2.5 million.
Mm-hmm. A lot more.
In my opinion.
You capitalize, what is it, $400,000 we get now? $400,000 a year?
It's $400,000.
You capitalize that over a period of time, and you've got a pretty good investment there.
Yeah.
Yeah, and they're...
You get a return on your money in 5 years for...
Yeah, I mean, when we put out the RFP, we had 6 or 7 people who were interested. So there is an interest out there in people who are willing to pay, because our minimum was 400-something thousand, and we had half dozen people show up willing to pay it. So there's a market out there for it.
Okay. You got pretty good marching orders? Understanding from the board?
I understand. I will find out what I can about certificate of needs.
All right. Thank you, Ben.
Thank you.
Appreciate your time. Greg, you want to talk about update on consolidation options?
I do. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I do want to thank Brian and Susan and Barry for all the work that they've done, and also Sherry Hook. What we're kind of doing is taking a three-pronged approach to this. We're looking at internal functions, trying to analyze where there is some overlap and where we can look at savings in personnel. We're also looking at mandated versus non-mandated services to make sure that we're only doing what we're supposed to do and what we have to do, and making sure that we're meeting those standards, minimum standards for the public. But also, we're also looking at the personnel policy options. You know, should it be state personnel? Should it be under the county? If it does fall under the county, we may have to change some of our personnel policies because it has to be substantially equivalent to the state personnel. So we're in the process of doing all that. Brian has a field trip set up for Friday if you're interested going. Onslow County is in the process of doing something very similar to what we're doing. The School of Government is facilitating a meeting between the Board of Commissioners and their Health Board and also the DSS Board, and we were going to go and kind of sit in and be a fly on the wall for that meeting. But just wanted to update you that there's a lot of work that is going on. We're looking at all aspects of both organizations and how it would fit in under the county, and we're moving forward.
Thank you, Greg. Questions for Greg?
Yeah, I think we need to move faster on this because you have to have a 30-day notice for a public hearing. And I think this whole thing should be settled, and if we take over, it should be in the new budget, which we're going to be considering pretty soon. So we're running out of time, and I think it needs to be done ex post facto, really. But I think you just need to move on.
Well, that's kind of been our goal, is to have something ready for you by June 1st. So to give you that time before the July 1 for the 30 days.
What did New Hanover finally do? They merged?
They're still working on it.
What did Buncombe do? Did they finally merge?
Buncombe merged. It's my understanding that I think one position was cut in Buncombe. That they did the consolidated board. That still fell under county management, but they did do the consolidated board. That there was not a separate health board and a DSS board. It was a consolidated human services board, but the health director and the DSS director fell under county management.
What percentage of the fact that Onslow's military? What was there? Camp.
Lejeune? Yeah.
Lejeune. That's in Paris.
No, he was French. What percentage of the fact that that's a military county do you think plays into the fact that they want to merge? Do you think there's any consideration at all?
My understanding is they're just looking at it from an efficiency standpoint, similar to what we're doing here, to see if there are savings to be had, just from putting their departments together. And Friday's an opportunity to go down, and this isn't a presentation about how to do it. They're going through the process and are going to be asking questions of their DSS and health board, as well as of the commissioners, about how to work it out. So
what's the population of Oslo?
I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Well, as you know, I'm not for this. I've worked in both places, and I don't know why this board would want to take over this responsibility of being over these two boards. I mean, it's going to put a whole lot more on us, as far as I'm concerned, because we're going to be responsible for it. And they're both doing a great job right now. And, you know, my thoughts is if it ain't broke, don't fix it. And you're only looking at how many counties have done this for?
I think it's seven.
Seven now out of 100? That's not a good number. And
Most counties, the law really got passed in August. So there, I think there are a lot of counties that are looking at it, and probably in the same position we are, just evaluating the process. The reason why we picked Onslow is not that we so looked at demographics or anything else, it's just that the timing of it was good for us, that they were having that joint meeting with the Institute of Government, and they were facilitating it, so we thought it would be a good opportunity.
Have we got any counties that have done it and got figures on cost savings or cost, not cost savings, I mean?
I think Buncombe is probably the one county that comes to mind, and again, they consolidated, they added several human service departments to Health and DSS, and I think it was 240 some thousand, I believe it was actually two positions that they phased out, and they combined some of their internal functions as well, but that's the only one that comes to my head of hard numbers for savings.
So the savings was what?
I believe it was around $240,000.
For two people?
And they, I don't know what other efficiencies they may have found in terms of the
Susan knows the answer to that.
I'm sorry, one, okay.
She had a correction on the figure. How much?
147,000. Two administrators.
Yeah, all right. I was thinking they had some high-paid people if you got that out, too.
Of course, we've got that here, don't we?
No, sir.
Yeah, we don't have it.
The population of Onslow County, 180,000.
How much of you think is military-related? Just curious.
My fingers can't move that fast.
I mean, can you get that
out for you?
I mean, is that feasible?
I'd say 30.
Well, Richard's looking that up for us. Before we go to the next item, Craig, I'd like to, or did you have anything else to?
I did want to remind our joint meeting with ABSS is this Wednesday at the Family Justice Center at 11.
And speaking of meetings, Linda Massey has attended the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners meeting recently, is that correct?
I have.
And brought back for all of us the...
Craig went with me. He won't let me go, I'm kidding.
Mr. Massey and our county manager attended recently the North Carolina Association of County Commissioner meetings and brought back the adopted legislative goals for 2013. In the past, last year, we met with our delegation briefly. We met over at the Family Justice Center, actually, where we're going to meet this Wednesday with the school system. I talked to Rick Gunn and to Dennis Rydell last week to see if we could just get on their agenda. Obviously, the session's already started. They said they would be delighted to. They've already met with the school system. So we're trying to work out if we can get as many people as we can to come here next Monday for about an hour or so as they go to Raleigh. So Tori's going to be talking to you all about that if she hasn't already. But do we have one of these for everybody?
We do.
Okay, please, commissioners, before you leave today, if you'll take one of these, there's about 60 different items. Not all of them apply to us. Not all of them are we necessarily going to agree with. But what I would suggest is if you could just kind of look through it and make notes. If you've got specific ones that you'd like to bring up to the delegation next week, email Craig or Tori so we can get it kind of on a bullet list. We'll be able to pass it out. If you want to just come and talk and listen, that's fine too, but this is kind of our key. I know this is pretty much it, plus there was a summary brochure that had everything by category. So,
and one thing about the chamber legislative recommendation board, you know, the chamber has a legislative update kind of board, and they've asked for a presentation on county legislative goals. I've kind of gone through this, and also, you know, we have a couple of local bills that we're going to be looking at. One's one Clyde's working on with EMS. Well, that's a statewide bill, but one's EMS and one is working on the county line. I've done a presentation that I will get to you today for you to review to make sure, you know, kind of hitting the highlights.
Are you taking items out of this
yes,
as well?
Sir.
Okay, well, good. So we can bring that information.
Right, and I can get that to you after the meeting.
Okay. And speaking of the county line, again, I'm not trying to go into commissioner comments, but to tie into your report, I talked to Mayor Williams in Gibsonville about a possible meeting to get this thing resolved with Alamance Guilford. He contacted the chair of the Guilford commissioners what she indicated to him was that they'd be willing to talk, but she actually asked for me to call her and talk about the issue. I have called her, and she's not called me back yet, so as soon as I know something, I'll let everybody know. I don't know what direction they want to take, but I know we continue to have questions from people that live on one side or the other. So with that in mind, Tori, if you'll make sure everybody gets one of these before they leave today, we can look through that. Craig, do you have anything else?
No, sir.
Richard, do you have any more information for us?
Trying to get everything.
That's quite all right. We have two items on item 9 for closed session. I'd like to read a couple of motions and just talk briefly about them.
Mr. Manning, just got it. Possibly
10%. What was the question?
percent
of military involvement.
On a 10.
Possibly
10%.
All right. Thanks, Richard.
It's early in the morning.
Yeah.
Motion. First motion is that we go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute 143-318-11A3 in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the county attorney and the Board of Commissioners receiving a report regarding the case of Triumph LLC versus Alamance County, Triumph versus Alamance County, Caswell County, and the ACLME. And the case of the United States versus Alamance County Sheriff. This is just an update from our attorney. Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
Thank you, Bill. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
And then we have a second motion while we're in there to go into closed session, North Carolina Statute 143-318-11A6 to consider the performance of an employee. That is simply the follow-up scheduled for our county manager Craig Honeycutt to give us his feedback to our feedback. It should not take very long. We have those meetings scheduled for Mr. Honeycutt today, Mr. Albright in our second meeting, and then for our tax administrator during April. So is there a second to that motion?
Second.
Thank you, Bill. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, we will now go into closed session.
Chairman Manny, if I may, to have the liberty of a public comment here, because I think everybody will be gone when we come back, and it's in regards to somebody that's made a statement here this morning. Ms. Castlebaum, I respect you 100% as far as your background and so forth, and I bet you were a heck of an English teacher at Elon. But when you made reference to I have an agenda versus me stating that that person there shouldn't have one, my agenda is totally from the aspect of what I can affect legislatively from an elected official. And to me, there's a big difference between an agenda when you are trying to affect legislation and an enactment of legislation or a pursuit of legislation versus somebody who's just on another type of board like yours. If I was on your board, I would not have an agenda to affect legislation. There's a big difference in the debate there, so I hope you understand what I'm saying. I understand what you said. That's up to the chair.
Let me let you all have a discussion after the meeting in the interest of everyone's schedule. We'll now go to the next room for closed session.
Okay.